feel actually unqualified to even teach on it. But the Lord reminded me, kind of tapped me on the shoulder and said, you've been through a lot. And it's been my ambition to do things right. And I can't say I've always done it right, but it's been my ambition to do things right. David did a lot of bad things, but he was still called a man after God's own heart because he kept a sensitive, repentant heart. You're never going to be without sin, but you can be one who possesses a repentant heart. And in the ministry, I've seen ministers fall like flies to pornography. And as a matter of fact, we had a prostitution sting in our town a couple weeks ago. And one of the gals at our church played the prostitute, but she was actually an undercover agent. She came up to me crying in the prayer line, just hysterical. And she said, I'm so thankful that I go to a church that believes in holy living and that our leadership wouldn't be involved in this. I didn't know what she was talking about. So I kind of consoled her, and I found out that the FBI did a prostitution sting in our town. And so she was the prostitute, the fake prostitute, who brought them to a hotel. They made the arrangements to sleep together. Once they put the money on the table, she hits the button, they come in and arrest the guys. Three pastors were arrested in our town. Two teachers were arrested in our town. And if you're a pastor or a teacher in here, you know what it's like when you live a righteous life and people mess up and muddy the water because they can't or they won't. And that's just a horrible reproach on the gospel. And so what's going on? Well, here's the thing. Everybody notices when somebody does it wrong. Yeah. But nobody ever says anything when everybody does it right. And I've served under my spiritual father, who's been in the ministry over 45 years and done it right. Never been in trouble for embezzling or lying or cheating or getting a divorce. None of that. And I've made it my ambition to do the same. Tina and I had some real sharp disputes and real close times to where we wanted to throw our rings off and get a divorce. But we made a vow when we got married that divorce is not an option. It's not an option. And God can restore anything if you let Him. And now, we still have our moments of intense fellowship, but we have a great marriage. And I'm so glad to have a partner, like Miss Carol said today. Tim, you couldn't have had a milk toast. She just fall off, I needed a strong woman that could do some stuff on her own, And so that's what I got. Praise God. But I'm telling you, in ministry, we have to live beyond reproach. We can't be a shooting star. Somebody says, well, you're a minister, I'm not. I beg to differ. We're all ministers of the new covenant. The Bible tells us all to go into the world to preach the gospel. If the Bible tells you to go preach, then you're a preacher. So why should you expect anything different out of me than you do yourself? If I went to the bar after service tonight and had a beer, you'd go ballistic. But some people go and do that after service and don't think anything of it. Why am I held to a different standard than you are? Now, I'm not, by that statement, I'm not saying you can't drink or anything like that. I'm just saying that if you're going to hold me to expectations because I'm a minister, you should hold yourself to the same. Because you're a minister and you are leading people's lives whether you know it or not. That little fish you have on your bumper, yeah, that's sending a message that I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian. And you better not be driving like you're not. I might just rip it off and give it back to you when you drive right. See, I don't even put one of those on mine, just in case. I'm not saying that you have to live perfect, but I'm saying that it should be in our nature to live right. Jesus didn't do everything so we could go do anything. And there's this teaching out that's just, it absolutely floors me. I've been DJing with David Hunter on KSLT, and all the Christian songs now are, he loves me, I can't fall out of his grace, and all this mushy-gushy Christianity. And I'm here to tell you, God does love you. He's obsessed with you. He's a jealous God, and He only has good for you. But that's not excuse to run amok on Him and treat Him like somebody that you cheat on, like, some sugar daddy or something. Come on. God's Lord, He's Master, and He wants to be in relationship with us. So, tonight I want to talk to you about possessing an eternal perspective, and this is so crucial. This is the elementary truths of the Word of God. Actually, let's go up to verse 12 of chapter 5. Paul's writing to the Hebrew church, and I believe it's Paul. There's a lot of dispute about that, but Paul has a distinguishing mark about in his writings, and I believe he left that mark in this writing, so I believe it was Paul. He writes in the 12th verse, "In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's Word all over again. You need milk, not solid food." You know what that reminds me of? A scripture? "Ever hearing, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth." We are talking about that tonight. And if you come to church all the time, and you're always hearing, but you never are able to come to the knowledge of the truth to where it's appropriated in your life, something's wrong. You're a hearer and not a doer, and the Bible calls you deceived. So don't just be a hearer, be a doer. Paul's writing to this church, and he says, by this time, you ought to be teachers. You ought to be people who are teaching, not people who are being taught. And that's not to say that we are always, I'm always learning. We're always going to be learning. But by this time, there comes a time in people's Christianity where they should be able to teach. And he said, I can't even give you solid food. I wanted to give you some prime rib, but you're still on the bottle. So, and he talks about how this happens. Anyone who lives on milk is still an infant and is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. Can you imagine a 35-year-old going to a restaurant and ordering a bottle? And then after the bottle's done, the grandma throws them up on the shoulder and burps them. I meet a lot of Christians that, although aged, are still infants in the spirit. Don't know more than John 3:16 and footprints in the sand. And I'm here to tell you, we got to go a little deeper than that. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish both good and evil. Mature Christians can discern between what's good and what's evil. Baby Christians have a hard time. A baby Christian can't tell you that their milk's bad. But hey, if you're a baby Christian in here, don't feel bad about drinking milk. Crave the pure, sincere milk of the Word of God. But there comes a time where we got to grow up. And the way we grow up is by constantly using the Word of God and training our senses to discern between what's good and evil. I'll tell you, there's people that they can look at a diamond with the naked eye and tell you if it's real or counterfeit. There's people that can taste wine, and one taste, they can tell you what season it's made in, what berry patch it's made in, what it's made of, because they've trained their senses to discern those things. There's people that can walk into a room and feel certain things. There's people that have trained their smell. There's people that have trained their eyes. There's people that have trained their touch. People that are adept at those things because of constant use. In the same exact way, we need to train ourselves where the Word of God is concerned. We need to train ourselves where we need to control ourselves and where we need to not. If you're a baby Christian and you just got out of drinking beer and bar hopping, don't go start a bar hopping for Jesus ministry. Because you might fall back in. You got to train yourself. Grow to a point. My brother met his wife in the bar. You know why? Because he was in there preaching to his friend about Jesus, and she overheard him. And slid over and said, "Hey, what's this you're talking about?" She gave her life to Jesus, and now they're married, have 5 kids. Four kids. Just had one last week. But I wouldn't advise everybody to go into the bar and minister to people. Because he knows he's not going to go in there and drink. Can't bring reproach on the gospel. But I'm going to give you something here. So this is the elementary teachings. Therefore, let us leave the elementary teachings about Christ. And it tells us what the elementary teachings are. And go on to maturity. Not laying again a foundation. Here's our foundation. Repentance from acts that lead to death. One. Faith in God. Two. There was a whole movement that just focused on number two. Instructions about baptisms. Notice baptisms is plural. There's more than one baptism. The laying on of hands. Some people don't even know what that is. That's not a massage parlor. All right? Resurrection of the dead. And eternal judgment. And God permitting, we will do so. So we go on to maturity if God permits. You know, I built my own house with the help of others. But before I could begin to build anything, walls and stuff on it, I had to lay a foundation, right? And when I laid that foundation, the building permit guy had to come out and inspect it and say, it's good. And then once he permitted me, I could start putting up walls and shingles and all that stuff. But I had to get a permit to go on. In the same way, God says, you can't go on to maturity unless I permit that your foundation's good. You know how many Christians have a foundation but a blue tarp over it? Because they never got a God permit. God never said, oh, you got a good enough foundation, you can keep building. I venture to say that there's a lot of basements but no houses in the Christian church. And that's not an indictment. It just says, hey, let's get our act together. Let's go on to maturity. Let's stop sitting on the milk and being satisfied. And a lot of pastors like to keep their saints babies so that they're always demanded. But I'll tell you what, more sheep, more poop. I'd rather my congregants figure out through the Word of God how to overcome than have to come to me and with endless counseling sessions on how to fix and change their diapers. I don't want my church to be a bunch of cantankerous saints that I got to issue warm bottles and blankets and change diapers every Sunday. Because we haven't gone deeper than a sinner's prayer. If you're... Man, I don't even know why I'm saying this tonight. But if you're a pastor in here and you can't preach more than a salvation message every Sunday. Like I said last night, aren't you glad that we don't have to sit here and debate whether it's right to raise our hands during worship or not? Some churches are splitting over the color of the hymnals. Give me a Pentecostal break. That means a long one. Serious. We need to go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation. Once the foundation's laid, no sense laying it again. But I want to focus on this last one, eternal judgment. When I say that, what do you think of? And this is what's amazing to me. I say this in a lot of churches, and they look at me like a cow at a new gate. Don't have a clue what eternal judgment means. Does that mean we're going to go up and stand before God and He's going to spend eternity judging us? I hope not. Or like the old preachers used to say, when you get up to heaven, God's going to push play on the video, the VCR. That tells you what era that came from. On the VCR, and all your past sins are going to play before all of heaven. What part of throwing into the sea of forgetfulness don't we understand? Well, that was the ones before you were saved. I don't know about that. Because if Jesus saved me before I was even born, then He can save me from my sins after I was born again. Now some of you are saying, what? All this preaching, all this time about you can lose your salvation. Because when you stand before God, you're not going to be judged on the basis of your sin. You're going to be judged on the basis of what you did with His grace as a believer. I just recovered on that one. No, seriously. Your sins, once you came to Jesus and you made Him Lord, your sins are thrown into the sea of forgetfulness, past, present, and future. Somebody says, well, then why do we have to repent of them? Because we have a repentant heart. God wants us, God, when we come to God, with a repentant heart, God doesn't want... I'm not even going to get into that. Because well, let me just say it like this. Has anybody ever lived under this? Oh, I got to repent for every sin I ever did. Because of 1 John 1:9 says, if you repent, 1 John 1:9, of your sins, or your sin. Is it your sins or your sin? Sins or your sin? Because when I come to God, I come to Him and I say, God, if I have hurt you in any way today, if I've been disobedient in any way, I ask your forgiveness and I come to you out of a repentant heart. That's a lot better than coming to God about lusting after that girl that I saw walking down the street. And then as I'm repenting of it, I think of it again and I start doing it again. And then I've got to repent of what I just did, what I was repenting over. And then when I'm repenting over what I was repenting over, I do it again. And now I'm in a vicious cycle of repenting over remembering what I was repenting of. Can I get an amen? Amen. Has anybody else found themselves in that struggle? Yeah, 1 John 1:9 was talking about if we confess our sin, He is righteous and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all righteousness. And that's not to say that you don't come before God. If you know you've been wrong in a certain area, come before God and confess it. But the whole point is to have a repentant heart, not to make sure that you confess every sin and then you're forgiven of. This isn't a confessional. Wow. Eternal judgment. Eternal judgment. What does that mean? Well, the word judgment here is the word krino. And it means, let me make sure it's the word krino here. The word judgment is the word krino. And it means, yes, it means making a decision for or against. Alright? Judgment. See, when we hear the word judgment, here's what we think of. You sinner! Right? Or hellfire, brimstone. When you think of judgment, you think of standing before God, Him playing the videotape, we seeing all of our sins, Him pronouncing us to heaven or hell, and you know, we think of judgment. And let me just say, there is going to be a day of judgment. And we know that God's going to settle accounts on that day of judgment. And if God's going to settle accounts, then you better make sure that you've got a good accountant. And you've been keeping good accounts. And in other words, you need to be a good steward over what God gave you. Because the guy that had God's talents, when God came back, he buried his and he went to hell. And here's a guy who God gave him something. So he wasn't a sinner, he was a servant. I always say this, we go from sinner to stewards. And so, if I'm a sinner and I die in my sin, I'm going to be judged on the basis of my sin. But if I got out of my sin because of Jesus Christ and I became a steward, and now I have God's grace, I'm going to be judged on the basis of what I did with His grace, not sin. That's why the sheep and the goats, when Jesus told the goats to go to hell, they said, what for? He said, when I was hungry, you didn't feed me. When I was thirsty, you didn't give me something to drink. When I was naked, you didn't clothe me. They said, when did we see you like that? He didn't say, did you drink a beer? Did you cuss? Did you smoke reefer? Did you do all this stuff? No, He didn't say that any of that to the goats, but they went to hell. He said, whatever you didn't do to the least of these, you didn't do to me. In other words, I gave you grace and you were supposed to use it to help people, but instead you didn't. You used it as a permission slip to go sin and now go to hell. Huh? Notice they called Him Lord. When did we see you like that, Lord? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. So what's this about, eternal judgment? Let me say this, there will be a judgment day, and you will have to give an account. But this eternal judgment that's in the foundation of our faith doesn't have much to do with that. It does, but it doesn't. We think of eternal judgment as God judging us for eternity. And so we read that, And this is supposed to be a foundation in our Christian walk. But how many of you have thought about this? Just don't be bashful. It's very bleak in the Christian church. But raise your hand if you've never given this much thought or you've never heard a sermon on it. Raise your hand. Okay. So those who haven't raised their hand, you think about it all the time. Okay. Let me just say this. Raise your hand if eternal judgment has been a mystery to you. This scripture. Okay. Much better. Much better. So, what does eternal judgment mean? If, in fact, it's a part of my foundation, then that means I should know what it means. Right? Not to mention, not just this, but all six of these. I'm amazed at how many churches don't even know about their foundation. They don't even know what's propping them up as a Christian. You know, nobody comes to my house that I built and says, "Man, that's a beautiful foundation. That's one of the best foundations I've ever seen in my life right there. Holding up 660 Erlene Street." Weird name for a street, isn't it? But yet, that thing is holding up my whole house. Nobody's ever going to come up and say, "Wow, nice Christian foundation you got there." But it's what's holding up your whole house. You get the metaphor? You know what they call a house with a bad foundation? Condemned. I wonder if it's the same with a Christian. So this is good stuff to find out. Let's get on with it. What's eternal judgment? Well, eternal is self-explanatory. Eternal. Eternity. But judgment is the word krimo, and it means this: to make a decision for or against. I was planning on coming up here on Wednesday, but I didn't. Because when I got out of the studio after my radio show and went to make my way up here, the clouds were so low in Rapid City, and the rain was so predominant, and the temperatures were so cold, that I could have iced up on the way over here, and I wasn't going to do it. What did I do to make that decision? I made a judgment. I made a judgment call. I made a decision for or against. I said, either I'm going or I'm not. I called up Pastor Jeff and I said, "Man, it does not look good here." And not to mention, I felt like you were supposed to preach anyway. And I heard he did a fantastic job. Amen. If you were here, praise God. It's funny. I woke up in the morning with this feeling like Pastor Jeff needs to preach before I even saw the weather. So it was like I didn't have really a hard time making a judgment because I knew what God was saying, but I wanted to make for sure it just wasn't the pizza I had last night. So when I made that call or that text to him and I said, "I'm not coming, you go for it." I said, "If you feel pregnant, preach." What I did was I made a decision based on knowledge. Okay? I wish I could remember the statistic of how many decisions we make in our life. It is staggering. As a matter of fact, the number of decisions you make today are in the thousands. The thousands. Today. And it's a high thousands. Because our life is based on decisions. Here's where we glean most of our decision-making processes from our knowledge. Eve was dissed, and she became diseased because she made a bad judgment based off of Satan's knowledge rather than God's wisdom. Listen, Satan does not know the future. Oh, no. God is all-knowing. God is all-powerful. God is creative. Satan has never created a thing. He's just perverted what's been created. He's not a creator. Satan can't read your mind. Satan cannot tell the future. He is limited. I liken this. This is what Satan does with you. Satan puts some powder in your life and he stirs it to see if it's going to turn to Kool-Aid. To see if you're going to manifest that you've been entertaining it. He is a schizophrenic freak. He is. He is horrified, and yet he still thinks he's going to be God. So he doesn't know the future. And he's always a trial and an error person. Always a trial and error person. Or I should say, enemy. Okay? So God, on the other hand, knows all things. God does not limit himself to time. God is eternal. We're temporal. God sits outside of time. Wrap your brain around that. When we were, he was. He am. Everybody say he is. He never wasn't. He's always been. God's never forgotten anything because he doesn't have to remember. God can't lie. It's not that he won't. He can't. Because whatever he says is. If God calls orange black, guess what? Orange just became black. Because God is. Praise the Lord. God is. I don't want to be rude, guys, but this is such heavy stuff. I want to make sure that everybody's not distracted. So do what you can. God is. Say it with me. God is. All right. So don't you think that God has a better perspective than you do? Here's a great scripture for you. Proverbs 3:5. Write it down. Lean not on your own understanding, but acknowledge him in all your ways, and he will make your path straight. What does it mean to lean on my own understandings? It means I make decisions based off of my knowledge. Okay? I've noticed this in prayer lines before. When I've called somebody up and I wanted to pray for them, and, you know, you can get into a habit real easy, can't you? Where it's like, oh, they're dealing with this. Well, this is what I did last time, and it worked. But here's the problem with that. Jesus never did the same miracle twice. One blind guy, he speaks to him. Another blind guy, he gives him a wet willy in the eye. Wouldn't you laugh? Oh man, I think that's so funny. The guy comes up, he's blind, he can't see. Would you help me? What would you have me do? I want to see. And he hears, hold on, bud. What are you doing? Ew. And he rubs dirt in it. Wouldn't that make you blinder? But God has the ability to be outside of time. And we base all of our decisions usually on our past experiences. This is why it's so hard, because if we had a father that let us down, we base our relationship with God on our let down father relationship. And we have all these things that play that are a result of our leaning on our own understandings. I don't know about you, but I'd rather make decisions based on God's wisdom than on my knowledge. There's a place in Wyoming, I call it Thumbs Up Rock. It's right around Lusk, between Lusk and Douglas area, if you've ever driven to Cheyenne. And you'll see a rock there, Thumbs Up Rock, and the reason why I remember it is because my dad dropped me and my brothers off because we were fighting there and threatened to leave us. We were fighting in a minivan that looked like a Duster Buster, you know, and we were just kicking and screaming. Finally, Dad goes, boys, if you don't quit fighting, I'm dropping you off right now and you're going to walk. Well, you think we listened? No. We did not have any good eternal judgment. We had temporal judgment. So he slams it into park and screeches the van, throws the van door open, and drops us off, me and my brother. And my other brother goes, can I go too? And he takes off. Well, his diabolical scheme was to get around Thumbs Rock, because you couldn't see around Thumbs Rock, but you could see the road going up too, but you couldn't see around it, and he was going to wait for us up there. So we're walking, and I, being so wise and brilliant that I am, my brother asks me, is he really going to leave us? And I said, no, he's just going to go up around, and he'll be around. He's just scaring us. But we couldn't see him. Thank God. I didn't know for sure. I thought he was bad enough to leave us right out there in the middle of nowhere. You know, vultures pecking at us and everything. Fasting for 40 days between Lusk and Douglas. But nonetheless, we got around the corner, we saw him, and we went, oh, it was refreshing even to me. But it was interesting that I couldn't see Dad, and Dad couldn't see us when he went around the corner. However, if we'd have hiked up to Thumbs Up Rock, we'd have saw the whole picture.